Let's move on a little bit. So we now know how to make basic requests with URL lib. That's going to be, you guys are going to become very friendly with that module. What I'd like to talk a little bit now is what we actually send over the wire between two computers. You know, we could have our servers, you know, in this case, we'll use the Hipmunk example. We could have our servers make our request to Amtrak and receive HTML back from them. And then we can actually, you know, look into that HTML on Hipmunk servers. And that's actually what we do. But this is suboptimal. And let me show you why. You've written some HTML at this point. You know that it's somewhat complex. It's not very regular. There's, you know, you've got things like, you know, browsers are very forgiving. You can write HTML to look something like this, where, you know, you have an opening form tag and you have an opening B tag, you know, to make some text bold. And then you can forget to put the closing B tag, put your closing form tag, and the browser will probably actually render it appropriately. At least some browsers will. But if you were a computer trying to parse this, you know, you're expecting a B tag to have a closing B tag, and, you know, all of a sudden you can get, you know, lost in this loop. Depending on how complicated you want to make your parser, maybe you can recover from this like browsers do, or maybe not. But HTML is not an ideal language for computer-to-computer communication. And it turns out on Amtrak, we actually get their HTML, and I'm going to show you some of the heartache we have to go through to actually parse this HTML. So remember, I gave you some regular expressions during homework 2 to verify your quiz answers, to verify a username and an email. Well, these are a bunch of regular expressions that we actually use on Hipmunk to parse Amtrak's HTML. And as you can see, this is just a wall of text. This is extremely error prone. And, you know, you can see, like, we're actually looking for, you know, we're looking for a div with class availability. We can look for this span, whose ID is service span. You know, this is what a time looks like. This is really nutso. And this is not the ideal way of doing things. In a perfect world, we wouldn't have to hit Amtrak's web page. We would instead use an API that speaks a language more appropriate for this task. And such a language, if language is the correct word, might be XML. XML was actually invented in the late 90s. Specifically for this purpose, to have a regular way of expressing data between computer systems. I can't claim to be the biggest fan of XML, but it is fairly easy to parse. And in fact, you've seen a lot of it. Okay, so this is what some XML might look like. If you're thinking this looks an awful lot like HTML, you are correct. We have our first line, which is basically the document type. We have the same thing in HTML. Remember, we've been using HTML5, so our doc type looks something like this. And it's just the first line that says what format the rest of the document is. Now, the reason both HTML and XML have doc types and this tag structure is because they actually share a common ancestor in SGML, which was invented in the 80s. Now, the main difference between XML and HTML is in XML, every tag has to have a closing tag. So we've got opening results, closing results. The tag format's the same. You know, we've still got our less thans and our greater thans and our slashes to indicate a closing tag. But we have no void tags in XML. Remember in HTML, we could have the BR tag for putting in a line break. We never had a closing BR tag. That's because HTML doesn't require you to all tags to close. We had this notion of a void tag. The line break was an example of one of those. And it's just an opening tag. XML has nothing like that. Now, if you want a tag that has no content in XML, you could do something like this. You could include a closing slash before your greater than symbol. And in fact, there's actually a doc type for HTML called XHTML, which is basically says my HTML document is actually going to be valid XML. And instead of doing void tags with no closing slash, you include the closing slash before the greater than. And you'll see that a lot in XML. So the whole point of what I'm trying to say is that XML is very similar to HTML, but it's more rigorous. And it's similar because they share the same ancestor. Now, I'm not going to spend a whole lot more time on the structure of XML because we've spent so much time on HTML already. Just keep in mind that it's similar to HTML, but a little bit more consistent.